Okay. Welcome to Thursdays at 4. I'm Jennifer Gunn. I'm the director of the Institute for Advanced Study, and I want to point out that this is a big year for the Institute for Advanced Study. It's our 10th anniversary, so save the date. The Thursdays at 4 on March 10th will be a special Thursdays at 4. I also want to announce, because this is on a kind of tight deadline, that there is an Imagine Fund Arts, Design, and Humanities Chair, and the application process is a two-part process, and the first part calls for is a call for collaborations. That part is due on February 15th, so you can find this online. You know, look under Imagine Fund Arts, Design, and Humanities Chair. And just because I thought people might be interested, we're advertising it. Okay, next week's Thursdays at 4 is special. It's a program on Thunder Drums, exploring taiko and its impact on cultural identity through performance, conversation, and workshop. So there will be a workshop. And so there is both hands-on, the opportunity to investigate and touch the drums, and it should be a lot of fun in many respects.
And it actually starts a little early.
Yeah.
From 3:15 onward, you can come and meet the drums and drummers. 4 to 5 is the panel with performance, and then 5 to 5:30 is a workshop.
So come prepared to hear lots of good rhythm and get to do some of it yourself. Okay, and so today we are welcoming back to the board, so to speak, or the dull carpet, the Brecht's America Rehearsing Failure IAS Research and Creative Collaborative, and here to introduce the program is one of the conveners of the collaborative, Matthias Roth, who's an associate professor in the Department of German, Scandinavian, and Dutch. So I will turn you all over to Matthias.
Okay. Good afternoon, and thank you all for coming. If I'm not loud enough, please let me know. So this is a Thursday at 4 event, but it is also the second event in a series of Brecht and Weil events that will happen this spring on campus. And it started yesterday with two talks by Kim Kowalki, professor of music at the University of Rochester, and Elizabeth Diamond from Yale. And so this is the second event, and there will be an open rehearsal of the Three Penny Opera. There will be a staging a performance of Lady in the Dark, the Kurt Weill opera. There will be a smorgasbord at the Southern, where theaters from the community present not very well-known pieces of Brecht and Weill. And there is a program
there,
somewhere,
right?
It should be there, so
them.
Please grab a program.
There's lovely brochures.
Yeah.
So grab them.
And I also, before I come to this event, I also want to briefly say who is the organizer of the Brecht and Weill Festival. So it is the theater, it is the Department of Theater, Arts and Dance, it is the School of Music, the Department of German, Scandinavian and Dutch, and we had the generous support of the Institute of Advanced Studies, of the Center for German and European Studies, and Lisa, did I forget?
Yes, the Kurt Weill Foundation.
Of course. The Kurt Weill Foundation very prominently, generously supported us. So,
is this them? Yay.
This whole festival is called Brecht and Weill, Together and Apart, and Kim Kowalki brought us a little clip where we actually see Brecht and Weill together, but also apart, as I understood, yeah? And maybe we play this and you can say a little bit about it? So we play it first, and then,
yeah.
Okay.
So, this is exactly 30 seconds long, but I thought if you had this in your hands, you'd see that we don't really have on the cover a picture of Brecht and Weill together. They're sort of spliced together, but that's probably not accidental or even so much of a decision, because even though they have become this sort of Siamese twin entity, Brecht Weill, you mention them in the same breath, one without the other, they only work together closely for 4 years, and it is remarkable how few photographs there are of the two of them in the picture together. I don't think there are more than a dozen during the four-year period. But in the last 10, 15 years, two film clips have come to light. One is from 1927, that's the first one. It's about 10 seconds long. It's on a ship in the Ruhr River, and Brecht and Weil are on it because the Ruhr industrialists brought them there to write sort of a propaganda industrial show about the Ruhr Industrial Valley. And when they found out what Weil and Brecht, after they toured a coal mine, Weil and Brecht were appalled at what they saw, and they were going to write this big critique of the Ruhr, and so they said, no thank you, you don't have to do this. So that's all we have of the Ruhr project. And the second one is from, we think, the rehearsal period of the Three Penny Opera. It's not in the theater, it's outside the Schiffbauer Dame Theater. And this was probably part of film that Carl Cook took of the whole piece, and it's disappeared. But we have about 20 seconds of the rehearsal outside, so we can run. Obviously silent. Brecht on the right, Weil on the left. I think that's all there is. And here we are a year later, 1928. One forgets how young they were at that time. I guess we'd call them together there. Pretty soon you'll see them apart. Because someone's going to separate them.
Who?
Well, we'll see. Come between them. Look at how young Brecht is.
How old is he here?
He's 30.
Yeah.
Because
28, he's 30. Yeah.
Yeah. And there's Lange in between. And that's in Brecht's studio.
So many people who read lips, when they don't discern what they're talking about.
Oh, that's a really great idea. This has been shown in some documentaries, and no one's made that attempt, but what a great idea.
Thank you.
So they're together in the crowd.
So before I introduce the panelists, I want to say a little about this whole idea, Brechtian Legacies Expanded Theater. So this panel is part of an IAS collaborative that Lisa and I do, and part of that was a workshop where we explored with students and faculty the idea of an expanded theater. It is not something that you should know because it doesn't really exist yet. It is modeled after the concept of an expanded cinema that was something that came into being in the 1960s with television, with new projection possibilities, with new mobility. Artists and theorists asked themselves, what would it be, a cinema outside of cinema? Or how could the cinema effect be reproduced within other media or within surroundings that are foreign to cinema? And we thought that this is a question that we could equally ask for theater. What would theater be outside of theater? So this was the starting point. And we wanted to explore the usefulness of this concept. And there are, of course, rival concepts. There's the concept of performativity, and there's the concept of theatricality. But it seems that if we understand them as lenses, it seemed to us, we discussed this a lot, so there's no final conclusion, but it seemed to us that both of these concepts, performativity and theatricality, leave something out. And maybe it is a bit schematic, but with performativity, what you focus on is the becoming of something, the becoming of things that we used to see as results. They come to be seen as constructed here and now, they become events. This is more or less applicable to all forms of behavior or interactions. And it is not very specific to theater itself. There is no idea of stage involved, not necessarily an idea of spectatorship. So with theatricality, it can mean too little and it can mean too much sometimes. So I talk about certain uses. if it means too little, then it is only a feature of somebody's behavior, a characteristic. If it means too much, then it is understood almost ontologically. It is what grounds every form of behavior along the lines that wherever there's a body, there's a stage. So this was a bit too much, and the other idea was a bit too little. And we thought that with expanded theater, we get something into view that is different. So it is an exploration of this concept as a lens. So we tentatively understood expanded theater as a targeted intervention, and it presupposes and implies a stage, an imaginary stage, not a physical stage. And for example, forms of writing, forms of scenic writing could be understood as expanded theater. Karl Marx, for example, in his reasonings in The Capital, very often backs his, not very often, but at strategic moments, backs his argument up by scenes where workers at a break hang out, spontaneously form social bonds to support his main argument. You could tentatively understand this, for example, as expanded theater. But why Brecht? What does Brecht have to do with that? So the answer is, the simple answer is that for theater to expand, it has to become reflexive. It has to develop an awareness of its means. And if anything defines Brecht's theaters, then it is this kind of awareness and self-reflexivity that, for example, shows in the many theater within theater scenes that happen in his plays and that are also always a meta-commentary on theater, a reflection of the limits of his own theater. So, and once these means are extrapolated, they can become, and they become with Brecht, aesthetical political interventions, so to speak. But it gets more complicated because at one point in our discussion, we said that we should maybe see theater in its natural state as always already expanded, and being on a physical stage is rather a moment of enclosure. Mm. And I think with Brecht, you can also see this, and you can understand this as a dialectics. For example, in his text Street Scene, there is no real authoritative text that lays out Brecht's theater. There are a lot of scattered texts on theater, and one famous text is Street Scene. And in the Street Scene, Brecht supposes this as a street scene, a daily scene of interaction, as the model for theater. And I quote him from Street Scene: "It is comparatively easy to set up a basic model for an epic theater. For practical experiments, I usually picked as my example of completely simple, natural epic theater an incident such as can be seen at any street corner. An eyewitness demonstrating to a collection of people how a traffic accident took place. The bystanders may not have observed what happened, or they may simply not agree, may see things in a different way. The point is that the demonstrator acts the behavior of the driver or victim or both in such a way that the bystanders are able to form an opinion about what happened." So theater goes out to the street from the physical space and models itself after something that is not immediately understood as theater. This idea of the street scene is a secret response to another famous theorist of a famous reformer of theater, to Denis Diderot. In his 18th century treatise, The Comedian's Paradox, there is also something like a street scene. And Diderot evokes it to emphasize the need of these actions, these daily small interactions, need to be embellished in order to appear on stage. They cannot pass like that. So, in a way, you see with Diderot an almost opposite move. Diderot stabilizes these ad hoc presentations by providing a kind of theatrical character whose expressions they become. And Diderot goes the other way. He destabilizes the character and makes all these behaviors, attitude, gestures visible as tools that can be very targeted interventions. So it is a double move with Brecht and Diderot. Theater moves into the street, expands, and it retracts, only to refine and develop what it has found outside and to turn it into tools of aesthetico-political interventions, as I would call it. So the moment of expansion, or in different words, such as expansions have a moment. So they happened in the 1920s, they happened in the 1960s, and one can easily see that they are also, that they are political responses. They respond to forms of art that are seen as authoritative and that are connected with forms of, or seen as connected often with forms of authoritative governance. So it is a move against this. And it is not only a political move, as I said at the beginning, it is in epistemological underpinning. The idea is that art can provide something like a unique knowledge, and especially at times when society is in transformation, aesthetic forms have to change too. So it is not by coincidence that these two moments coincide, moments of political unrest and transformation and the development of new forms, of new aesthetic forms. So I don't know if we would be today ripe for another expansion. I will end before I say something about the panelists with a famous quotation by Brecht, in which you see this move against any what is seen as traditional forms of art, like naturalism or representational realism. And you see the connection between art being on the one hand a political intervention and on the other an aesthetic tool, right? Being as an aesthetic tool a political intervention, this is the right way to say it. So Brecht famously said, the situation has become so complicated because the simple reproduction of reality says less than ever about reality. The photograph of the Krupp works or the IAG companies reveals almost nothing about these institutions. Reality as such has slipped into the domain of the functional. The old concept of art derived from experience is obsolete. By speaking in this way, we speak about an art with a completely different function in social life. So this was where he situated himself, and this could be seen as a problem. His theater, or this movement of expansion that we saw in Brecht, originated. So our panel now looks into different moments and scenarios of an expanded theater. I will introduce our panelists. We have Mark Silberman. Mark Silberman is a professor at the German department in Wisconsin. He is one of today's most renowned Brecht specialists. He has written extensively on Brecht and on political theater. He has co-edited with Tom Kuhn and Steve Giles the recent publications of edited volumes Brecht on Theater and Brecht on Performance. And he is part of a team that prepares a new edition and translation of Brecht's completed work with Bloomsbury in London. We have Maria Hofmann. She is a PhD student in the Department of German, Scandinavian, and Dutch. She was also part of our workshop, and she presents her work in progress on a recent theatrical trend in documentary filmmaking. We have Juliette Chevalier from the Department of French and Italian, a scholar of intellectual history and early modern theater, someone who thinks far beyond the traditional knowledge boundary and has always been a great source of inspiration for me. She is currently finishing a book on theatrical violence and the kind of disruptive and always untimely present that such violence comes along with. And she might complicate our ideas of expansion being a modern phenomenon. I hope so. So, and last but not least, Lisa Chenna, an imaginative and lively original theater director, you know her all, with whom I had the pleasure to collaborate in for it's
for 100 years. We've been doing it. Yeah. I feel like it's been like 7.2
and yet
years.
It seems like
it's been a year and a half. Yeah.
So we run the IAS collaborative together. Lisa has her own theater company, Novi Most, and she is a professor in the Department of Theater Art and Dance, and she is the director of the acting program.
The BA performance program, but that's okay. Yeah.
And this is the way we proceed. Each of our panelists will give a short presentation of approximately 10 minutes, and immediately we will open this up to the public afterwards for a broader discussion. And Mark, yes.
Okay, thank you. Matthias, and thank you for inviting me here to Minnesota. I'm an alumnus of this university. I was an undergraduate here 45 years ago. I think I have brief comments, and I think I will give them under the motto of from Brecht, in German, wer wem, who for whom, who speaks for whom, who writes for whom, who makes theater for whom. So when Matthias asked me to come here to be part of a panel on expanded theater, I said I would be happy to do it, but I was embarrassed to admit that I didn't know what expanded theater was. Could he explain it to me? He wrote back and he said, well, expanded theater doesn't exist. We're trying to think about what an expanded theater would be. So I gave it some thought, and what could expanded theater be? Is it an expansion of traditional or classical understanding of theater as a technology of mass participation and social cohesion in the anthropological sense of performance? Or could expanded theater be a broadening of the basic aesthetic values of theater, so the essential nature of theater as a live event, its spectacularity, its visionary quality, its investment in meaning through dialogue with an audience, could that be what Matthias is thinking of with expanded theater? Or, and here's what I actually thought maybe it would be about, is expanded theater referring to the use of new technologies in the theater? And from your comments now, I think perhaps that is the direction you're going. That is, the use of media, the use of global networking, the use of robotics, of computer design, and mobile systems in theater performance. Now, Matthias just said in his introductory comments that expanded theater, I can't exactly reproduce what you said, presupposes a stage and a target audience. So I would immediately ask, how do we define the stage or a stage? What is, in fact, the space of theater in the expanded theater? How do we recognize this space as a stage or as the stage of expanded theater? If you speak of an enclosure, for example, this is an enclosure. It could be a theater. We could even mark off a space within this enclosed space that could become a stage, but we could also go outside here on the plaza and mark off a space, and I think that could be a stage as well. So enclosure can also be a virtual enclosure. It's something that a group of people would simply recognize at some point as being a marked-off space where a performance takes place. And in a similar sense, one could ask what constitutes the audience or what constitutes an audience. And I think, I hope in the course of the discussion, maybe we can discuss those questions. I don't have answers for them at this point. So, Matthias asked me to think a bit about theater in theater, the notion that Brecht talked about in German, Spiel im Spiel. I am not so sure that theater in theater corresponds to a notion of expanded theater. Theater in theater strikes me as being a stylization or even a reduction rather than an expansion. It refers, of course, to Brecht's notion of showing that has to be shown, showing the showing of scenes in the theater. So in a general sense, theater in theater, first of all, refers to revealing or staging, in fact, the imaginative effort that goes into theater performance. And I emphasize here imaginative, not so much the effort at the moment, but the imaginative quality of a performance. Second, theater and theater in a very general sense is an approach that uses theater as a communicative space. The actor becomes someone who plays and invites the audience to play as well, to play along. And this is goes beyond just language and dialogue for the theater in theater. And third, theater in theater melds together this amorphous mass of spectators, or at least potentially it melds them together, into a participating, conscious, self-conscious group in a particular time and space. In the Brechtian context, theater in theater refers to the breaking of the fourth wall illusion, that is to stepping outside the fiction so that the play acting is shown not only to the audience, but also to the figures on stage who are acting. While our figures on stage are themselves then an audience in that theater in theater. And it's this doubling process that produces a scene that functions in the plot, but also generates a communicative situation that sheds light on the entire play's conception and the intended reception. And this then would bring in many of the things that Liz Diamond talked about last night, that is the separation of elements that Brecht talked about, the Verfremdungseffekt, the gestus, the not but, the stance. These are all the kinds of techniques that Brecht introduced as part of theater in theater. Now, Matthias, in his introductory remarks, talked about both performativity and theatricality, and I thought about those two in the context of expanded theater, because they seem to me to be two of the developments in theater, theater studies, theater scholarship over the past 20, 25 years. I'm not so sure that I agree with your evaluations of where performativity, performance studies, and theatricality have brought us. Performativity, to me, suggests a view of theater with an emphasis on its cultural and situational specificity. It's true, performativity, performance studies, tends to avoid issues of aesthetic autonomy. It privileges the integration of performance into social and cultural processes. And in its most capacious variants, performativity might include, in fact, all kinds of dramatic arts, such as dance, opera, pantomime, circus, as well as public activities in which a public participates, such as sports events, games, and rituals. So possibly it's that kind of inflation that you're referring to when you talk about expanded theory as being something different than performativity. Theatricality, on the other hand, is an approach or is a view of theater that is aware of theatrical conventions and the audience's self-conscious perception of them, but it also is aware of that outside of the traditional theater space. For example, in the street. Street theater is a form of theatricality. In therapy contexts, in clinics, hospitals, family counseling, and so on, role-playing in these kinds of situations, or anti-theater itself, something that entered into theatrical performance in the 1960s. For some, theatricality is actually seen as a liberatory or subversive force that challenges precisely the illusion of transparent or unmediated representation in the theater, effectively revealing all representation as theatrical. And I think that overlaps to a large extent with what I understood you to have said, maybe expanded theater. So I don't think I will say anything further about the specifics of theater and theater in Brecht. I could start listing all sorts of different examples of that. Almost every theatrical text of Brecht has some form of theater and theater. I'd also like to remind you that theater and theater in the Brechtian sense goes beyond the narrow notion of theater. You have court trial scenes, as I'm sure you're aware, Caucasian Chalk Circle. You have boxing matches. Last night, the little excerpt we saw from Threepenny Opera, the jealousy duet is done in a boxing ring. Very nice touch, I thought. So we could perhaps discuss that further. I was interested in hearing your reference to Street Scene, the 1938 essay that Brecht wrote, where the entire essay is aimed at negating the illusion of the very possibility of a realistic reenactment of an event. The Street Scene is an essay about the ability, the possibility of making visible events, making visible what happened as a foundation for intervening in a socially progressive way, in a socially significant way. I would like to suggest that maybe one way of thinking about expanded theater would be to consider what would happen today in a street scene when we have smart streets. Mm. We have cameras at every intersection. We have sensors on the streets. We have sensors on cars. We have GPS, mobile tracking. What kind of demonstration would we have in a street scene today? One would have to read the Street Scene essay by Brecht to think about what the demonstration would be that could take place. But I think to the extent that public space has changed, we're in a situation that the very concept, the very practice of political theater in the sense that Street Scene is suggesting it, probably is going to have to change as well. Mm. I think I'll stop there. I have some more comments, and I was particularly interested. I think you mentioned that this is in the series on failure as well. Brecht has some interesting ideas about failure, so maybe we can come back to that then at a different point in the discussion.
Potent.
Okay, I'll go next.
Expanded aesthetics from the perspective of film, and more precisely from the perspective of documentary film. My point of departure is Brecht's understanding of the document. Traditionally, a document is a written account of something that happened, ranging from transcriptions of conversations, legal documents, even thoughts. For Brecht, the document is not something that accurately represents reality or things as they happened. Instead, the document is only a construction of reality. And this reality must be created and invented on stage and witnessed by an audience. Instead of establishing a direct link to reality, the document in Brecht's sense represents the relationship between reality and the imaginary of what happens on stage, the scenes, stories, and characters. Theater employs its fictionality for almost a sociological truth-finding mission. It creates documents. This means that the document becomes reality on stage. Today, theater scholar Stephen Bottoms argues that effective documentary theater has to follow Brecht's lead. Documentary theater is a trend that started in the early 2000s in the UK. Plays in this category usually base their narrative on pre-existing real documents which are explicitly recited, often word by word. Bottoms argues that for these plays to be effective, they need to address their, quote, ambiguous status as both document and play, end of quote. Thus, their relationship between the actual and the fictional. This requires a kind of theatrical self-referentiality. Exemplar dramas by, for example, Moises Kaufman, draw the audience in while simultaneously distancing them by, quote, foregrounding their own processes of representation in order to acknowledge the problem, which is of being documentary and play at the same time, and encourage audiences to adopt an actively critical perspective on the events depicted, end of quote. One example Bada mentions is Kaufman's play Gross Indecency, The Three Trials of Oscar Wilde. The play shows and recites written sources from these trials, which at times contradict each other directly. This reminds the audience that history itself is a complex construct and there is not one unmediated truth. Exposing the complexity of the story in its many facets shows the audience constantly that the story is mediated. Again, what effective documentary theater does is not only to use real documents, but also to address the complicated relationship between the real and the fictional. Additionally, on a self-referential level, they also draw attention to their own complicated position as documentary and play. As a result, the audience is put in a position of critical action, presented with the complexity of a story. They need to question and reconsider the depicted events. I argue that there is a similar push in documentary film. These films play with the relationship between fiction and reality in order to go beyond the idea of a mere factual truth. Traditionally, documentary film aims to be as objective as possible and sees its strength in its ability to represent reality. One example is the movement of direct cinema in the 60s, in which a fly on the wall perspective was thought to be most appropriate to find truth. However, the problem with this is the belief that there is something like one truth and that it can be represented. After all, filmmakers shape their films according to their own ideals, beliefs, and goals. Even pointing the camera at a certain subject rather than another already is a conscious, subjective choice. In this new development, however, new films give up the claim to objectively show reality and instead draw attention to the discrepancies and inconsistencies of their stories. One example for this development is the documentary film Stories We Tell from 2012. It was also nominated for an Academy Award. The filmmaker Sarah Polley goes on a quest to find the true story about her late mother, interviewing and almost interrogating family members, friends, and colleagues. At first, it appears to be a traditional documentary from a personal perspective. Over the course of the film, though, layers and layers are peeled away to show an image that is far more complex and faceted than expected in the beginning. What happens is that Polly's quest for a portrait of her mother turns into a quest to find out who her biologic father is. When the film starts, the narrative seems to be predictable. Instead, the interviews reveal turning points. It almost feels like watching a detective story. The interviews are intermittent with a vast amount of camera footage from the 60s, 70s, and 80s. It provides visual evidence for the claims made in the interviews. Written accounts read by the actors complement the original footage. The filmmaker's father, for example, wrote down the story from his perspective and continues to read from his notes. Polly herself read some of her emails in voiceover. Despite of the plethora of available documents, with the testimony of witnesses, the written accounts, the pictures, and film footage, it rather underlines the discrepancies and differences in the story than coming to one more conclusive version. Here we have Sarah's father talk about the editing and the version of the film.
When you finish writing this, you realize when you finished all this, you know, about 6 hours of stuff, and you'll decide what you want out of it. It'll be exactly like the story. Each one of us will pick out if any one of us were trying to edit it and decide what we wanted to keep, it would be the same farcical kind of theatrical exercise that we're all involved in. Oh, I want to keep that. Oh, that's rubbish there. That's an enormously different thing from simply doing an interview straight and never doing any editing of it whatsoever, but letting it run as it is. That would have been at least as close to truth as you can get, whereas your editing of this will turn this into something completely different.
But Zara's father points out here two important aspects. First, he believes the truth could best be found in the sum of all versions, but that second, through Paulie's editing, the film itself becomes a document. And furthermore, the film stages something like a collaborative creation of this document. Additionally, the film is continuously self-reflexive about the ethics of storytelling. Different characters address the issue of how should a story be told, who has the right to tell it, whose memories are important, etc. So here we have a scene where Sarah's biological father speaks, and he is not a fan of the idea that everybody gets a say in it.
Does not get the truth simply by hearing what their reactions are. People tend to declare themselves in terms of what they saw, in terms of what they felt, in terms of what they remembered, and in terms of their loyalties. The same set of circumstances will affect different people in different ways. Not that there are different truths. There are different reactions to particular events. Crucial function of art is to tell the truth, to find the truth in the situation. That's what it's about.
In these moments, the position of the viewer transforms from a mere observer to an active participant. These questions motivate the audience to interrogate their own memories, their own stories, and how they are much more than a linear narrative that has developed over time. Paul herself gives an account of her approach.
What would you say this documentary is really about? Am I breaking the fourth wall here? Turn the camera around.
What is it about? I feel like it's about a lot of things. I think
memory is that.
Memory and the way we tell the stories of our lives. I think in many ways it's like, you know, trying to bring someone to life through people's stories of them. It's also.
Is this a good angle for me? Sorry, go on. Telling people what?
Asshole.
Hi, Harry. One of the main focuses in the documentary are discrepancies in the stories. All of us, you, me, my dad, my siblings, my mother's friends, etc., have similar stories with large and small details that vary. I'm interested in the way we tell stories about our lives. About the fact that the truth about the past is often ephemeral and difficult to pin down. And many of our stories, when we don't take proper time to do research about our pasts, which is almost always the case, end up with shifts and fictions in them, mostly unintended.
Stories we tell doesn't need to give access to reality, nor does it represent reality. Instead, it creates a document which reveals the real on the boundaries between artificiality and authenticity, fictionality and reality. One should grasp reality as a multifaceted, always mediated construction. Factual concepts of truth have to plank out many versions in favor of coherence. The concept of truth in documentary theater and in these documentaries, on the other hand, aim to present the real as complex and multidimensional in which various perspectives and accounts can coexist. Thank you.
So much for having us all here. I'm going to talk very quickly and then I'm going to show you two clips. Yesterday, Liz Dime, I'm really interested by what Mark said about, is it who for whom?
Yeah.
It's so great. I'm a theater director, so I'm going to talk from that perspective as an artist. I was going to talk, yesterday Liz Diamond posited that the dirty secret about Brecht is that he's formed a comic theory, a theory about comedy, and I agree with that 100%, and I want to talk about it a little. I was going to write about my current work. I was going to talk to you about these last 2 years I've spent working on a critique of Brecht and his women that he worked with. But I've been thinking a lot about how Brecht reaches way farther back to inform my very earliest creative work in the theater. And since it's the anniversary of Roe versus Wade this year, I'm going to start with my first professional work. This skirted the worlds of art and politics in a very Brechtian way, which I didn't understand fully at the time. And it sowed the seeds of this feminist call that continues to this day in a slightly more nuanced form. My first company from 1989 was called Sleeveless Theater, and it was born out of rage. There were five of us, all women. We were about 20. We were seniors in college, theater majors. The Webster versus Reproductive Rights decision came down in the Supreme Court, which some of you may were not born yet, and some of us may remember it. It gave states broad ability to limit access to abortions. So it allowed any state that wanted to start to impose difficulties in getting abortions to go ahead and do that. And one of the most extreme parts of that decision was that it allowed a state to decide for itself when life begins. So in Utah, it might begin at conception, and you have to protect a fetus from conception on it. In New York, it begins at birth, and so-and-so, third trimester. It got to be this crazy map. Well, we were 20, sexually active. We had grown up post Roe versus Wade, and we had not really considered that abortion would ever really be threatened. This new, very virulent backlash against feminism was just taking hold post-Reagan, and we were angry, honestly. We were angry, young, and creative, and had energy. We decided to dig in deep, and we did an exhaustive research year, just learning about the history of abortion and birth control, which was fascinating. It is really this, when you really look at it, it's a brutal history of ways men have tried to control women's bodies. And you can be pro-life, pro-choice, whatever you want. That's basically what it comes down to. And the morality issue of it is very recent. And it's a very interesting history to look at. So we read this brutal history, we got to really know it, and then we made a comedy about it. Because we realized that the only way to really talk about this where everyone in the room could be open is to laugh about it. No one thought you could make a pro-choice comedy. No one thought you could laugh about abortion, and we found this way to do it, and I believe that it was a Brechtian inspiration that allowed us to do it. The play was called Womb for Rent. It was a big hit in 1989, and it launched us on 3 years of 3 years of having these premieres that were these brash political comedies ranging from the Gulf War to reproductive rights to feminism. These plays think kind of National Public Radio meets Monty Python, which is what we were called by one theater critic. They were smart and funny, and they toured all over the country. Look at this, Backlash Blues. We were touring to college campuses, we were touring to theaters, we were touring to benefits at Planned Parenthood in South Dakota. We were all over the map. Our audiences, which is really interesting, cut across lines of race, gender, age, and technical savvy. And many of the patrons that we were performing for were folks who had rarely, if ever, attended theater. Although we did play at the Public Theater in New York and at Wow Cafe in the East Village, and we performed in Chicago, we were, look at us, with George Bush number one there. That was a piece called Do-Si-Do and Pass the Buck about the military chain of command. We did it about the first Gulf War. So in a way, this is before Amy Schumer, you guys, and it's before Tina Fey, and it's before, it's when the comedy that you were seeing that was politically relevant was almost 100% male. John Belushi and the like, right, had done brilliant work on Saturday Night Live. They were our inspirations. The Monty Python guys were our inspirations. There were no women. There was Lucille Ball, who got spanked on her TV show. And there was, of course, Carol Burnett and Gilda Radner. There were a few. But we were really feeling like we were landed on the moon, and we just decided to tell the truth. We did have, however, we were touring in these wonderful circles that were going on then, which Mark knows about, Split Bridges, Culture Clash, Alarm Dog Rep, some of these wonderful comedy groups that were starting to talk about politics in a comic form. We we did some work in New York that got us reviewed by Alyssa Solomon in the Village Voice. So we were doing this stuff, but we were feeling that we were completely on our own, really. We were picketed and threatened by pro-life groups in very violent ways in South Dakota, which is a whole other story that I could tell you about. What an odyssey to understand the underbelly of that movement. And then we were sort of hailed as unique and fresh by theater critics. What we were doing was essentially Brechtian feminist comedy. We were taking what the world thinks it knows about human experience and alienating it, alienating all the assumptions. In many cases, in a patriarchy, this simply means telling a story that's not about or for men, and that's by women. This is already, you're like an alien, you know, as Holly Hughes said, all I have to do to be obscene is walk on stage, sit in a lawn chair, and say, I'm a lesbian. That's it. That's all you gotta do. And so in some ways, just by showing up in the forum we were, and telling the story as we know it, and breaking assumptions, we were already doing what Brecht is talking about. So in telling this truth, through women's lenses, our audiences were able to question how we got to the assumptions that we even hold about what women are. I'm gonna show you, we have to exile Santa Fe. Look at little, we're so young. Oh my God, that's me on the left, Jesus. Woodstock, that's somewhere, look at us, goofy. We were just so little and great. There we are, Rooms to War, we did a piece about the Gulf War. So that's just some press. I want to show you two quick clips, one clip. We're going to figure out how to do this, I know we are. Nope. There it is. Okay, so I'm going to show you 2 minutes of the man-made woman sketch.
Just so you know that that's your next.
Cheers, time. Beautiful. Very little video exists of our earlier canon from Sleeveless Theater, but this is a piece we did called The Man-Made Woman Sketch, which attempts to show an audience, mostly again, frat guys, we went to college campuses, what is it, how do you make a woman, how is a woman made? And well, you'll see what we did. Thank you. rough and silly. We were, just to be clear, we were 20. And you can imagine this being done in rallies for all kinds of issues, from peace to pro-choice to feminism. We played for like 3,000 people out in South Dakota, where we were threatened with violence. It just for this, it's amazing what we went through. And I want to fast forward now very quickly and share with you the latest of my works, a very short excerpt. This is a critique, a Brechtian critique of Brecht. And again, my sort of feminist work is, here we go, this is the one. Very quickly, you'll see, this is Rehearsing Failure, about Brecht's relationship to three of the women in his life, Elizabeth Hauptmann, who you'll see him talking to, Ruth Berlau, his wife and partner, who you'll see him, you'll see her watching a film of herself and him reciting a letter from her, or to her, and Helena Weigel, who you'll see just at the very, very end. And there's two Brechts, that's all you need to know. And again, it's a feminist critique of Brecht that I think would not have been possible. I would not have been able to make this had I not done the 10 years of In the Trenches feminist comedy, Brechtian feminist comedy that I was doing in the 80s and 90s. And so this has been a speech about me. Thank you.
The things we had to take. Typewriter. Reading lamp.
She contributes a few things here and there, which makes it feel more important than she actually is. So he kicks her out because he grows tired of her, and she ends up alone. The poet puts his name on the manuscript, because if he didn't actually write every word, he owns every word, because without him, none of those words would exist. She thinks, why did this happen? But she never blames herself. She's a coward. She blames the men. It's all their fault. They're all against her. She could have been somebody if it wasn't for all these men.
That's really good. I like that. But we do need to change a few of the words. Instead of saying she wanted her name on the marquee, why don't we say she wanted her name on the title page? And instead of saying she contributes it here and there, why don't we say she wrote 80% of it? And let's say she actually gets paid. Now, back to Galileo. I think that we should put a cigar in his mouth so everyone knows his breath really stinks. And give him a monologue about what it's like to have a ridiculously small penis.
Oh, no, but it would destroy my creativity, you know that? Being so far away, thinking of you straying, it would destroy everything I ever built. Like war destroys cities. And then again, I suppose, not unlike war, love finds its way. I'm going to have to have faith in you.
I made her put it down, I made her minimize. your slideshow.
Okay.
Which is not metaphoric of anything.
I understand. I understand.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I do totally know what you mean. Oh. Here we are. We're good. I maximized it.
Thank you. I want to be your supportive feminist ally in that. So.
Yeah. I don't know how that's going to work. I'm definitely the outlier here. I'm just going to try to go a little quick. That's not true. I'll try. I don't know if I'm going to be able to. I was thinking also about, so my work is in the pre-modern period, and I was thinking about expanded theater and listening to, tangentially a part of the work on failure that the collaborative did last year. I've been hearing about this project for a long time. And I've been thinking about what expanded theater really means. I think I was in a similar position to Mark, where I was kind of wondering, okay, so if it doesn't exist, do I get to choose what it means? Thinking about the ways in which theater can be present in milieu other than the stage and the way in which it brings other milieu to the stage, it seems to be that the motion we're describing goes from the theater to the street and back again, or from the street to the theater and back again. I'm not quite sure how it goes. So in response to that notion of expansion, I'm going to offer a theoretical argument about expanded cinema that's disguised as a historical one. So I'm not actually interested in teaching you about the past, but I'm interested in troubling this model of a contemporary or modern notion of expanded theater. And so the historical argument is that at least since the late medieval period, since I did take the trouble to make this slideshow, I think I'll show it to you just for fun. Since at least the medieval period, theater is always expanded. I'm not sure why. Let me just put my watch down. Theater is always expanded. That is to say, theater is everywhere. This is a 15th century royal entry, a procession, and this is an illumination. I think it's about this big in the book. It's a really, really small image, and I'm sorry, the quality of these are not terrific. So it's always been expanded, and scholars of medieval Europe have done a lot to establish these movements. Royal theaters, performances of a royal authority, instances of justice. This is a Bruegel called Justice. Here's Justice, the scene of torture. Religious pageantry, for example, which all of these are comprised of choreographic actions presented before a witness in public upon whom an effect is supposed to have. An effect is meant to occur. In French, we would gesture toward these mutually informing social arenas through the word échafaud, which means scaffolding, connoting both the temporary structure you make to execute somebody in public. You might know the film Elevator to the Gallows, Ascenseur à l'échafaud, but also the temporary frame that one erects for theater troupes, which, oh, it's so crappy, I'm so sorry. But in the background of this martyrdom of St. Apollonia, patron saint of dentists because she had her teeth ripped out, you see, in fact, scaffolding that was very much like medieval theaters, and in the scaffolding behind, you see the audience, which is comprised of a variety of people dressed in all sorts of clothing, but also includes kinds of monsters and devils. So is this a martyrdom? Is it a presentation of a martyrdom? Is it an allegory? It's very difficult to know. I'm going to leave that up there because it's so gross. So basically, European theater was already expanded. It existed in many arenas. Instances of performance and witnessing that were meant to be somewhat exceptional. See what we got here. This is the Saint Bartholomew Day massacre painted by François Dubois, who was a Huguenot who survived this massacre of Protestants in Paris in 1572, and he painted this painting well after. And I just love the way in which there are these tableau-like composition, these gestures that are so symbolic in their choreography of the massacre of this Protestant nobility. Dubois escaped the massacre and painted this years later. This isn't a picture of what happened. It's impossible that it would have happened this way. And it's probably unlikely that Marie de Medici stood over on the corpses, but you get the idea, right? So painting is then also a moment of performance, a site of expansion, of theater, right? I'm going to skip my foray into the 18th and 20th, my comments on the 20th century. It's basically Foucault. I'll just say the word Foucault. and then I'll also say that here, you wanted to know where the stage is, it's right here, right? Thank you for being such a good bourgeois audience, laughing when you're supposed to be quiet most of the time, perhaps falling asleep when we get boring. This is all within the framework of what theater is now. So, lest I simply be here to tell a not very helpful origin story, let me offer a more precise example of why I think it's useful to think about theater's expanded internal frame, the fact that I think it's built with expansion already in it, from my own period, which is the 17th century. I just wanted to leave that up because it's so long.
Yeah.
So that's just going to be up. You can just look at it. So the 17th century is that very period in French history called classical. The classical age, it's the age of Racine, Molière, Louis XIV, Versailles. It's the period that practitioners of theater see as having proudly instituted the Aristotelian constraints of the unities of time, place, and action. And I've actually heard you say this.
Right.
So it's not. So this idea of heroic accent, what really makes tragedy, what makes theater, it's the fault of the French in the 17th century. It's also the time when institutions that regulated theater came into being. The French Academy, the first national theaters, the regulation of theater also emerged along other subtle forms of discipline, like the fact that theaters began to have a home. They were no longer itinerant in Paris. They had permanent buildings. They played on specific days so you could count on going to the theater, much like the movies later on, at predictable times of day. So again, now we're in contracted, what I think Marc called restrained theater, I'm calling contracted theater, where theater becomes codified in a certain way and disciplined. And yet in the middle of this contraction, this discipline, and tons of public debates about the problems of theater, its dangers, practitioners sought other mobile spaces of performance. And the one they found was publication. So arguably, from our perspective, print is just another space of codification. It's where you fix the text, if anybody here is writing a dissertation, for example. You fix it, you make the performance predictable, subject to reiteration. But in the 16th and 17th century, oh, I just wanted to throw this up. This is a 1670 tableau, very famous of Molière's troupe, supposedly. This is complicated. This is a tableau. It's meant to echo the St. Bartholomew Day's massacre tableau in a funny way. So, but let's get to print. And I apologize for the quality that continues from it. This is all from Henri Jean Martin's book on print in the early modern and modern periods. An unbelievable source of information. So in the 16th and 17th century, publication was much more clearly than today another site and form of performance which escaped the time, space, and economies of the theater. If print emerged in the late 15th century, it took until the early 17th century in Europe for a lot of economic and political reasons for the printed word to circulate more generally, for books to become objects of consumption that a lot of people would buy. So cheap books emerged, for example. And it's in the late 16th century that printing plays really took off. Playwrights would rush to print their plays, first in order to safeguard, well not first, but yes, in order to safeguard the stage performances, but also to guarantee the re-performance of these plays in other locations, salons, spaces of collectivity, where the plays might be read aloud, for example. And we have a lot of evidence, which I'm going to show you, that playwrights began to change what they wrote, what the plays consisted of because of printing, right? So I want to say in the 1500s, plays were not really Aristotelian. They were hairy. They had five acts, but they had like 21 tableaus and choruses coming in and out, and they were just really, really hard to print. So what printers did was just printed the whole plot, just gave a plot summary on the very first page of each act, right? And this is a scene that has, I think, three people in it, if I recall. And look at this, they have to explain the whole, all of the action. Other printers borrowed from typographic conventions. On the left, we have Molière, L'École des Femmes, in which the ingénue Agnès reads a book on marriage. And what the printer did was to show that she was reading something, he took a typographic convention from a title page and he slapped it into the book. So that when you look at it, you've got a title page within the book. On the left, this is the one of the wackier things I've ever seen. You can't really tell, but the bottom figures, so the top figure is the dialogue, and the bottom figures are actually notations for what is going on in the scene. This sign is a pause. Here there are two people. Oh no, here's two pauses. Here's three. This one is where he turns, I can't really read that, towards all of the theater. This one he's speaking low, etc., etc. So they're trying to write stage directions or direct it. And these are not director's notes, right? These are not how you're going to perform the play. This is what's literally going on stage, right? So my favorite is, you know, how do you write a crowd talking all at once? How do you print that? How do you print the distinction between two voices when the actors are hidden? My favorite example, however, because it's massively important to my field, is how do you print a battle, right? Well, what you do is you write batai, battle, and then you write something like That's your battle on stage. That stinks. That's a terrible battle. And then you describe the battle. Then you describe it, right? Also bad in a certain way, although we should talk about ekphrasis, which is something that Matthias mentioned. So these creative solutions don't last long because theater, I think, adapts to the problems and demands of print. And very quickly, theater no longer features battles. We're used to making the argument that it's actually the moralists and religious authorities who chase violence off the stage because theater is bad and it shouldn't show violence and that's bad for the people. And then what we get by 1677 is Fedha, in which nothing happens. The most significant thing that happens in this play is those two lines at the bottom of Fedha's first tirade. She sits down.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. She'll die later, but it's off stage. Nothing happens in this play.
Well, her knees are trembling.
No, it's assié. Oh, yes. Okay, but that, you know. Okay. So there's this very limited palette of actions that theater ends up embracing, I think in part because of its performances elsewhere. So my point is that theater's expansion into print rebounds back into theater itself and affected what was performed, how the world was interpreted and interpolated. So if theater has always been contracting and expanding, under what conditions then, I want to ask you guys, can we possibly see, what are the conditions under which theater could be called, following Foucault, something like a curative science? To go back to this idea of a theater of change, of progress, a theater of critique that maybe does something. I think, and I'll end here maybe, that there is I think that expanded theater needs to pay much more attention. Since it doesn't exist, it needs to pay much more attention to how the technologies of theater are redeployed. And here I offer up a different kind of technology for you. I think about things like scenery, simulacrum, gesture, oration, tableau as possible technologies of a very different order, not unfriendly to the technologies of today. I'm thinking about how these are deployed. And I won't talk about Peaky Blinders. Because I'm getting the fisheye from Matthias. But if you want to see expanded theater, it's in the very first episode of Peaky Blinders, which starts with a theatrical gesture, real theater within theater, within TV, within Netflix, and repeatedly features tableaus that are totally theatrical. So, thank you.
So we have a little time for discussion, but before we do this, I just wanted to say that your talk about the moment of expansion and retraction, that this is maybe something you can capture better with an idea of expanded cinema, this going out, going back, refining to it, going out, than you can do with theatricality. This is a moment maybe that is a moment that can be a moment of distinction, this double move of retraction and expansion. So this notion is very much up for debate and exploration. So this is all work in progress. And I now open up for for questions, comments, and we can use the microphone. We don't have to.